Hello, and welcome to another episode of The Writer's Showcase, hosted by me, Alexander Hamilton. Actually, it's me, Tom from Goldspot. Wanted to say hello and talk to you guys today about a few different items, one of which being this guy right here, Alexander Hamilton. We had gotten a big shipment in of Atramentis that we have been missing for quite some time, and it includes inks like this Alexander Hamilton, which I know have been very popular, but we haven't had our hands on them in months. So shipments finally come in. We have a whole bunch of Alexander here and his friends, so we could take a look at that first. Welcome again, and welcome to the Writer's Showcase, and this is Alexander Hamilton. It is characterized as an aubergine, which I think is extremely appropriate for this purple ink, which is very, very dark. It has a beautiful color, beautiful purple eggplant sort of color to it, and just really, you know, has a nice smooth flow coming out of this Pelikano up, and I wanted to talk about that at the same time as well. So Pelican has a line called the Pelikano, which is typically considered to be a kind of like an entry level office supply or younger generation. So it's kind of like a kid's first fountain pen or a student type pen. This is the up is what they say upgrade. It's kind of like their version of the Lamy All-Star or in the LX. So it's more, has a very muted color palette that's more modern and sophisticated metal clip, as opposed to typically, I believe they're usually like a plastic sort of clip. I should have brought another Pelikano just for by comparison. It's a very shapely body. Could be considered to be, I suppose, unisex of color scheme and of shape here. One of the things you'll also notice here is the contoured grip section, which has kind of like a ribbing, and that's, by the way, that's Alexander Hamilton, my finger there. The Pelikano Up has a similar grip section to the Safari and the All-Star, where it's contoured so that your fingers meet right where that right where they're supposed to be here. So this would be where your index would be to kind of, and the grip is here to kind of maintain more control on it. And then the thumb would be right here. You'd have your middle finger would be underneath to support. And it's supposed to promote good penmanship, good ergonomic grip to it. Stainless steel nib, just like you would expect with any lower end Pelican. Good solid feed to it. Really the only, the thing that I had found with this is that the Pelican converter actually does not fit in the Pelikano up here. So what I did to fill it with Alexander Hamilton was to take a standard Schmidt converter and fit it in there. Really the only issue wasn't the fact that the converter was too long or that it was too wide to fit in the opening, but it just didn't fit on the feeder area there that the cartridge would be pierced by. So I picked up one of these. These are a Monteverde. It's just generic Schmidt type fountain pen converter, and jammed it in here, filled it up with ink, and it worked very well. I was able to fill it through, but the only thing was it kind of has like a little bit of a looser connection than I would typically prefer for a converter, so just be careful. I would really jam it and fit it in there with a nice tight fit, because you don't want it coming loose when it's inside the pen. The body has a cutout very similar to your Safari or All-Star to see where the ink level is, although it's not going to really help you with it being more towards the ending part of it. And just like the All-Star or Safari, you have the Pelikano up is engraved in a subtle way on the back end of the barrel. So it does post in here. So a pen is fairly normal in size. There's a good light weight to it. as you would expect, it's like an aluminum coated sort of plastic. It doesn't really have like a metal, even though I think it bills itself as being metal. I don't think it really has that much metal in it. The cap, I believe, has more metal than the barrel does. But other than that, it feels like a good alternative to your Lamy Safaris. The medium nib on this is very nice, very smooth to write with. And it responds well to nice, quick handwriting gestures. I mean, that could also be said of the Alexander Hamilton ink here. It's very pleasing to write with, has a good wet flow. And this usually comes with a single ink cartridge to start with in Pelican Blue. The standard international long type cartridge. That Pelican does have a good amount of varieties of color now that they offer it in the Edelstein collection as well. They have the 4001 giant ink cartridges, and then they also have the Edelstein, which come in the little tin. In the ink cartridges as well. So you have a good variety of colors there, even if you don't decide to throw the converter in here. And when we do list these on the website, which we will do shortly, we will also list a recommendation to get the Monteverde converter that I've put in here, since the Pelican one doesn't work. And you would assume that it would, being that's the Pelican pen, but it doesn't. So that is the anthracite model, which is kind of like, it's a gray, so it's an anthracite medium point. So let's take a look at the champagne, or as Christopher Walken likes to call it, champagne. So this is the champagne color. Nice creamy silver, just a very hint of kind of like a yellow or gold. Nothing so that you would say, oh, well, this is obviously like a gold, you know, a very light gold pen. It's really not. It kind of has more of a creamy silver look to it, just but with like a just very little hint of an off goldish sort of color. Same thing here. We have the grip section molded. Little back part here is for the middle finger to rest on, and white trimmings around the collar where the nib is, and the section here. Nice secure snap-on cap, like we did with the other one here. This one also posts on. It's not a click post on. You have to kind of really put it in there to get it nice and tight. But when it's in there, it's in there. So this is running for the Pelikano Up is running for, I believe it's gonna be $25 retail, which is really good considering that if you're comparing this versus a Safari or All-Star, that's right around that same price point, if not better. You know, your Safaris have gotten up there in price over the years, so this actually has a more approachable price point and is also still made in Germany. Like I said, the only issue being that you'd have to buy a converter separately, which people who buy Safaris and All-Stars know that you'd have to do that anyway. So Pelikano Up. This is a really good, you know, good solid everyday starter type pen, a good upgrade from, say, if you've been used to getting a lot of the inexpensive, let's say, Platinum Preppies or, you know, the Noodlers pens. This is a good, this is another good alternative for that first-time fountain pen user. So I wanted to answer, Michael Elson had written a question just right before our broadcast about stub nibs, and I want to illustrate that point by showing two different stub nibs. He had that question regarding the fact of whether stubs have tipping material or do not, or if they could or could not, I suppose. But I just wanted to illustrate that point by looking at two different nibs, which I would consider a stub, even though one is referred to as a calligraphy nib. Versus saying it's a traditional stub. Traditionally, a stub is going to have tipping material, and the tipping material is going to, you're going to see that by that bulge that's right at the end of the tip. And that tipping is usually iridium, which is a hard wearing metal, harder than stainless steel would be. So that's why they use it. They want to make sure that that tip's going to last on there for a long time. And the tip is balled up, it's shaped. Okay, so we're looking at this, and this is the italic, what Pelikano refers to as an italic nib, but this is actually a stub. Italics would have a harder edge, and this one's got like a round, if you could see, like if you look at it right dead on here, you're gonna see that the edges, the corners of this nib are rounded. And that's really what characterizes a stub, is that the stub is rounded for more writing comfort. It doesn't give you that scratchy feeling that, let's say, a cursive italic would. And I think I'm seeing here is that the nib has already started to wear for me, or I've actually put some time in adjusting it and smoothing it out. So I might have over smoothed it, it looks like, on the right side of it here. But it does write very smoothly for me. I do enjoy this nib a lot. But this is a true stub nib. It's got tipping material to it, and it's rounded on the edges here to give a smoother handwriting experience. Whereas a cursive italic will give you crisper lines with better variation, it will be a little bit more scratchier. This is now the Nemosyne. This is what you would, I got a piece of lint on there, it's gonna bother me. So this is what they consider to be the calligraphy, like a calligraphy type nib. And as you can see, like the nib material itself being stainless steel, it's coming all the way to the edge. There's no glob of tipping material on here. So you're just dealing with the straight stainless steel here, which is rounded, as you can see here. It's rounded similarly to how the tip on the Pelikano is. So you can see like it's got a very noticeable curvature to the sides. You know, and this one too, I had to kind of fiddle around with because it was overly scratchy for me, and it really wasn't giving me much flow, so I kind of adjusted it for flow too. But the tip here does not have any iridium on it, so it's going to get worn out at a faster rate than the iridium tip would be. I'm going to have to end up, if I write with this constantly, or if I, you know, play with it, I start grinding it down, it's going to wear away at the actual nib itself. So, you know, may change the characteristics of ink flow and everything else to be, you know, to the actual writing experience here. But the results are very similar. You would get a line that has a thick downstroke. So I'm just zooming up on here. Thick downstroke and a thin side-to-side stroke, a thin horizontal. So thick and thin. Okay, so this is filled up with, I'm trying to remember right now. This is filled up with, KWZ Iron Gall Gummy Berry. And this is the gummy berry compared with the Atramentis Alexander Hamilton. So you can see there's some difference here. This is a little bit on the bluer side. It's got a little bit more of a red color. But yeah, this is what you would expect from, you know, anything that kind of bills itself as a stub. Give you the thick downstrokes and thin side-to-side strokes. Oh, missed a stroke there. All right, so we're going to take a look at that Pelikano. Now, given this nib is a bit broader in terms of the stroke than the Nemosyne, the Nemosyne is, I think, is a 0.6 millimeter calligraphy type nib. This italic, I think, is probably about 1.0 if I were to measure it with a pair of calipers. It's got a very big, you know, downstroke to it, and decently thin horizontal. So it's the same principle, just two different ways of approaching it. Which is the better of the two? I would probably say the true stub with tipping material, because like I said, it's tipped with iridium, so the iridium is going to last you longer than if you were just writing with a nib that was just that the tip was cut off. Another nib that's like the Nemosyne that we carry, is the Lamy Joy. The Joy's got a stainless steel nib. It's cut off at the end. It's flattened out completely, not kind of round off like this is, but it's even more severely. So it's kind of like a cursive italic in that way. And but it doesn't have any tipping material on it, not like the regular writing nibs do. Let's take a look at something different. This came across my desk today. And this is nothing new. It's nothing new, but I won't say it's anything, you know, not worthy to mention. But I figure it'd be worth mentioning because we need to give some love to Jerry at Laban. Laban's a great company. It's been around over 30 years, you can see there. Makes some awesome quality pens at a really great value. Awesome value for these pens. So this is the Mento. And not many people are familiar with these, and I really want to give him a shout out because this is a fantastic pen. This is made out of acrylic resin and has a beautiful whorl pattern to this resin. This is the one of the Tornadoes. Let me just see what color. It's called Blue Tornado Laban Mento. So if you type in M-E-N-T-O on our website, these puppies will come up. And if you notice, kind of right off the bat opening this box, this pen is big. You look at it up against the Pelikano M200 here, and you notice that it's got a good half an inch in length, and also the girth that just completely beats this Pelikano out of the water in terms of size. Got a nice big thick cap, big bodied. It's got stainless steel two-tone nib. Comes with cartridge or converter fill, standard Schmidt type converter, plug-in style. And really what is amazing about this is the $112 $112.95, I forget which one exactly, but for a little bit over $100, this is an amazing good value. It's got the chatoyance to that material. It's a thick resin, so you can hear it's not like a very thin. It goes all the way through. Just check that out. That is so awesome. Just looking at all the swirls down there. It's a well of swirls, and you can just tell from like the way that the threads are ground here. You know, just the way that things like sound when you put them together. It's just very excellently finished. It's got a great polish to it. And these are available in a wide array of different psychedelic trippy colors. So I definitely would check these out if you are looking for, let's say if you like Edison pens, which I know Edison pens, even our production line pens, they go for about $149 on our website with a steel nib. These Labans go for a little bit over $110, and you're looking at some fantastic finishes, an oversized model. It does post. It's kind of big when it's posted. You can kind of see it's a little bit on the big side. But massive props to Jerry he just always sticks it out, man, and he's a guy that he shows up to a decent amount of the pen shows during the year. He's a bit on the older side, so he doesn't get into the whole social media thing. He probably would never see this video, but I might end up emailing it over to him just so that, you know, he could take a look at it. But he's a really great guy. Runs Laban here in the United States and makes some great quality pens. So I just wanted to give him a shout out. Another thing we want to take a look at, as I'm just putting that guy away here, is a new product from Cross. So I wanted to play with this. I wanted to try this out over the weekend, but I didn't get a chance to. But I wanted to talk about this because of its potential implications as a 21st century item for pen enthusiasts. Or just in general, for somebody who values small items, this could be a game changer here. This is the Cross leather pen pouch with a tracker-enabled Bravo chip. So what does that mean? This guy right here is what the system's all about here. This is a Tracker Bravo chip by a company called Tracker. It has an app built behind it that has several hundred, I don't know, I mean like several million people, they say, that use this app. I have not gotten a chance to download it yet. I've not gotten a chance to use it, but I do intend on trying this out. And if it does what it says it does, this is going to be a really beautiful thing. Because here we are, we have a Cross leather zip pen pouch. And we're going to, this is me unboxing it for the first time, so I'm just kind of figuring it out here. So it's not genuine leather. It's a leatherette. So it's a bit on the stiffer side, but it's got a nice supple grain to it. Bright yellow zipper here. The zip's open, and we have a nylon interior, which is great because if you get ink stains on there, it probably should be easier to clean out than cleaning them on a leather or another porous type material. And you have a little pouch that's right here. And this little pouch is actually meant, I'm just plucking it out here, there we go. And this is meant for the Tracker Bravo chip. Now what this all does here is that you would be able to put your pens inside here. So let's say I put my Nemosyne, pop that on in there, zipper it shut. And what would happen is if, let's say, you know, I brought my stuff to a coffee shop, to a restaurant, you know, let's say pen meetup, or a hotel or whatever, and I left my bag behind. Oh no, you know, I left my stuff up on the counter, or it slipped out of my pockets in the cab. So this pouch has that tracker chip in there. And the way that the tracker chip works is it has a Bluetooth signal that communicates with the network, the tracker network. And what really makes this work is the fact that there's several million people that use this. And what we'd hope would happen is, let's say if you've been disconnected from your pouch and your belongings, that you would log on to the tracker app. And you'd be able to, hopefully, would be able to come across a signal that would be passed only to you confidentially if somebody who's using the tracker app comes within a certain distance of this pouch with the tracker chip in there. So what that would mean is that, let's say, you know, you left this at a cafe, busy cafe, so a lot of people come in and out. And no one necessarily needs to spot this, but what would happen is if a cell phone with the tracker app on there comes within range of the chip that's inside of this pouch, then an alert would go off on your phone through the tracker app and would let you know, this is where your pouch is. This is where the chip is located. So then you'd be able to drive over there, and hopefully it's still there. Now, really, the one of the things that I would say is going to be a problem is in the case of if somebody just took it, like, you know, and didn't want you to find it. Of course, all they'd have to do is just remove this guy from the pouch and discard it, or throw it in a river in trash, or bury it somewhere, and lo and behold, all of your rest of your belongings are gone, and you're just left with the chip. Conversely, you'd be able to use this as well to find your cell phone. So you'd be able to send a signal to your cell phone to locate your cell phone as well. So if you don't have your cell phone on you, and it's, let's say, stuck between couch cushions, or you know, in another room that you don't usually, on a shelf you don't usually put it on or whatnot, you'd be able to use this to set off an alarm that even in silent mode would be able to ring your phone to locate it. So that's a pretty cool feature too. I mean, this is not expensive at all. I believe this is retail goes for $35. I believe so. It's definitely a worthwhile investment if you carry your pens with you everywhere you go, and you're always worried about losing them. It certainly is worthwhile. And what Cross is actually going to be coming out with soon is also the Peerless tracker enabled pen, which is the first pen that acts like it has a LoJack system on it, which works the same exact way that this tile chip does. But it's the tile chip is inside the pen, so it's already built into the pen. They have replaceable batteries for this. It takes like a standard type of, I guess, a watch battery and whatnot. So Laura Walker just chimed in here. She says she's got a tile and it has a tracker chip for her keys, which is really cool because I think that's a competing company, if I'm not mistaken. With tracker, and that's tracker is T-R-A-C-K-R without the E. So let's put this back here. And yeah, and I definitely want to check this out. I want to try it out and maybe just do like a quick like YouTube video to show you what it takes to just install the app, to actually test out how well this works. So stay tuned for that. So just to kind of go over what we had just talked about, we have the Pelikano up in the two colors, the anthracite and the champagne. Then we also talked about the Atramentis and the fact that we've restocked a number of the colors that we've been out of stock of for months, including Alexander Hamilton, which is this color here. It's a beautiful aubergine dark purple color. So if you are missing out on Lamy Dark Lilac, this is a good alternative for a nice dark purple. And then we also answered Michael's question about Stub Nibs, talking about tipping material that's on Stub Nibs and what's the difference between that and ones that don't have tipping material, like this Nemosyne here. And so if you guys have any questions, always feel free to give us a call or send us an email. My email, of course, is tom@goldspot.com. Feel free to send me an email or talk to us, and we'll be glad to answer them. So have a great week, guys. Take care.